lot of great information that are going to be presented by our wonderful partners from the Minority Male Community College Collaborative. Dr. Harris and Dr. Wood will be presenting. Dr. Harris will be joining us momentarily, but we're going to go ahead and get started. We do have a limited quantity of these books, and so we'll leave. So if you're here and you did not get one, we do want to make sure that you have access to that. We also want to let you know that through our partnership, you're going to have all kinds of access to these two amazing men that are going to be presenting. We recently did an additional partnership with CORA, the Center for Organizational
Responsibility
and Advancement. And what we're going to be offering is a certificate for teaching men of color. So this is a one-week online program that is going to be made available to our campus. And so as soon as we get booked, ooh, you see the faces up there? That's good. And then there's also going to be additional presentations that are going to be made. They have been on our campus for the past year. We have been doing surveys. We have been doing focus group with students and faculty interviews. And so we are compiling data that's specific to our campus. And as we move forward with professional development opportunities, they will really be targeting those areas of need for our campus. So we're very excited to have this first presentation on microaggressions. And with that, I will introduce our esteemed presenter.
Okay. Thank you. Really appreciate it. It's always great to be at this institution and looking out and be able to see so many people that we know, so many of the students who are in our doctoral program or have graduated from our doctoral program. So my name is Luke Wood, and I'll be presenting today with Dr. Harris, who is in the back. And we're going to talk today about microaggressions. So how many people know what we mean when we say microaggressions? Okay, so some familiarity. This will probably, like, as soon as we start talking about it, you'll be like, oh, okay, I get it. Yeah, I know all about that. So, what we're going to talk about is basically a way of kind of understanding microaggressions and then having a good understanding of how that then influences students and their success in college. So, the title of this presentation is Microaggressions, Redressing Inequities for College Men of Color. So, to kind of give a background of microaggressions, it's good to give actually the context that it emerges from in terms of like the scholarly perspective. So microaggressions actually is a theory that emerges out of what we call critical race theory. So basically in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, there were social activists who really had saw that the civil rights movement was like a primary way to engage and create parity for underrepresented communities. And there were people who, as a result of the strategies that were employed, became dismayed because they felt like, you know, there wasn't enough change that was happening because no matter what, like, you know, we still see disparities in, you know, employment, we still see disparities in housing, in educational access and completion. And so there was like this critique of like, well, hey, that strategy doesn't work because we're not getting at the root of this all. And the root of this really is thinking about how laws and policies are being created to basically perpetuate and continue racism. So actually a good example of that would be Brown versus the Board of Education. So like, for example, Brown versus the Board, 1954, most people think, okay, well, that had a great ending to basically segregation in public systems, particularly schools. I mean, that's what we think about. But then, like, literally the next year, the Supreme Court came back and had Brown 2, which said, make sure that you do all this, but at all due speed, right? And which was interpreted by many of the states to mean we can do whatever we want, and then became essentially a protracted battle. So there was the folks who basically came out of, who kind of created this school of thought called critical race theory, really thought there's a need to kind of counter this kind of incrementalist view and say we need to push for real changes right now. And so, and also as part of this, there was a focus on race. And, you know, recognizing that oftentimes when we talk about issues of inequities, it's easy for folks to go to the go-to of, oh, it deals with class. And while class is important and there's other forms of marginality that are important, the people from this school of thought were really like, you know, but race is central to all of this, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. So I'm going to give you a couple of the tenets of critical race theory to kind of undergird this, and then we'll go into the microaggressions piece, which comes out of it. So in terms of critical race theory, the first tenet is that racism is a permanent part of everyday life. Now, some people say that and they say, wow, that's kind of sad, right? And the reason the word permanent here is used purposefully, because there's an understanding that in our society that there will likely not be an end to racism as we know it, right? Because really it will just continue to manifest in different forms. So one of the things that coming out of that is this perception that racism is enduring and normal, right? Hear the word normal, say that racism is normal, may strike some of you as saying, okay, well, what do you mean it's normal? Well, what they would do with the scholars from critical race theory perspective, they can look at different countries around the world, different contexts, and recognize that no matter what, no matter where you go, marginalization is evident. Whether we're talking about racism, or whether we're talking about tribalism, or whether we're talking about religious differences, no matter where you go, there is a hierarchy, and that hierarchy is based upon something. And what they said is that in the U.S., in here, in this nation, the hierarchy itself is really organized around race. And so it's normal for us to experience these kind of things. So oppression itself is part of the human condition, because again, wherever you go, you're going to see these different manifestations of oppression. That we shouldn't view this as being pessimistic, saying that it's enduring, it's normal, it's going to continue forever, but view it as empowering. And if you ever heard Derek Bell, who's one of the like primary critical race theorists, one of the things he says, he said it's like basically this perception that racism is permanent is empowering, because it's like knowing that you have like a terminal illness, right? You realize that you're not going to be able to necessarily change it, but that doesn't mean that you don't strive to create a longer lasting life, a more healthy life, and do the best you can with the time that you have. So as a result, this perspective is that the centrality of race and racism, meaning that we should be focused primarily on race and racism, while also recognizing that there's other forms of marginality. Some examples there. Another key component of critical race theory is that we need to challenge the dominant ideology. Basically, when we see things that are unjust, we call them out, we confront them. Another key component is interest convergence, which doesn't matter as much today, but this piece does, the commitment to social justice, meaning that we're going to confront racism, right? And for a critical race theorist, that means partially identifying what that looks like. So what does racism look like? Because, most people don't, have to worry about getting beat up on the way to school, right? But we do recognize that there's still an underlying racialized experience that many people have. So while racism itself has changed, right, in terms of how it is manifested, it's still there and it's still permanent. So we have to basically confront that. And then maybe the most important piece of all of this kind of like critical race theory undergirding is this notion of experiential knowledge, right? And that's that the belief that in order to really understand what's going on, you need to talk to people and you need to understand their experiences. And not just looking at the dominant experiences, but looking at those counter experiences, those people who are on the margins. And with our work on men of color in community colleges, we recognize that oftentimes on the campuses that they are the students who are on the academic margins of the institution. And there's a lot of data, there's a lot of research to support that, and we know that they have experiences that are different. So for us, it not only entails doing surveys to get at their experiences and their perceptions, but really sitting down with them, doing focus groups, talking with them. And as a result of kind of that process, we've been able to illuminate just some different pieces of the microaggressions that we think are going to be useful for this conversation today. So you'll see here that we'll actually provide quotes that are from students. Some of it's from research literature, some of it's even from faculty members talking about the perceptions of students. So it'll be important. And these last pieces here in terms of critical race theory, and that's basically the distinctive aspects of it. So if we're going to kind of recap, what is it that we need to know? This is it. And basically, critical race theorists want to challenge existing scholarship, right? So what does that mean? Well, most scholarship basically positions students in a certain way. If you were to go back to like the 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, most of the research, for example, on students of color presents them from a deficit perspective, saying that there's something wrong with them, that they don't try, that they're not working hard enough, And so if we wanted to do something to improve student success, we need to be focused on remediating those students, right? Whereas a newer version of scholarship would say, instead of focusing solely on students, we might want to focus on students as well as the educators who are working with them to make sure that they're actually prepared to work with these students and looking at what is it that's taking place in the institution in terms of policies, in terms of practices, in terms of those interactions between people that perpetuates inequities. The other piece, of course, is that race and racism are front and center. And then this last piece here that is really important, it's important to name things. It's important to identify and put and essentially taxonomize the experiences that people have. And that's what really microaggressions does, is it takes something that's really kind of hard to put your finger on, and it gives names for each different component. So, racial and gender microaggressions, seemingly innocuous actions with powerful effects. So, here's the definition of microaggressions. Racial microaggressions are brief and commonplace daily verbal, behavioral, or environmental indignities, whether intentional or unintentional, that communicate hostile, derogatory, or negative racial slights and insults towards people of color. You know that's an academic who wrote that because it's exceptionally wrong. So, what is that really getting at? Basically, microaggressions are those kind of micro interactions where basically a message is communicated that basically denigrates someone. And there's different ways in which that occurs. And it's those subtle things that people say to people, right? Or do to people, or how people they make people feel. And it's hard to actually put like your finger on what just happened to me. Like, I just had this interaction. I was just standing at the counter, and I was the next person in line, and then they just went to the person who was right behind me. I'm the only person of color here, and they went to a person who's a majority person, and they asked them if they needed something, and I was clearly the next person. So it's those kind of experiences that it's hard to say, is it just me? Am I overreacting? Maybe I didn't do something to make them realize that I was the next person in line. And so it actually messes with you psychologically, and there's a lot of research that says that it actually has a more deleterious effect on your psychological health than actually direct racism, because you can put that in a box. You can say, hey, they just called me the N-word. I know what to do with that, right? I know what that is. Versus this, it's a little bit harder to understand what occurred. And that's why Gloria Ladson-Billings refers to it as 1,000 daily cuts, because it happens so regularly, and it seems like something that's small, right? But over time, it has a very negative effect on people. So microaggressions, just like from this critical race theory perspective, are pervasive, they're normal, and they're daily occurrences. Again, they're pervasive, normal, daily occurrences. Examples of them are things where you feel put down, subtle snubs, dismissive looks, reactions from people. And again, it can be more psychologically damaging. Now here's the challenge with it. When you try to say to someone, what you just did was a microaggression, it's very hard for them to receive that. And there's the primary reason that is we like to think of ourselves as good people, right? In general, if you ask someone, you know, what kind of person they are, they'll say that they're a good person. They'll say that they're an ethical or moral being. They'll say that they care about other people. And you know what the truth is? They probably do those things, right? And they probably conceptualize, but that doesn't mean that every action that you have, right, isn't a reflection of how you've been socialized to perceive other people, right? So it's an important piece to remember. So it can be difficult then to say to someone, hey, I don't know if you realize, but you just microaggressed me, or you just made me feel this way. And for them, you're affronting them and the essence of their being by saying that to them, in their mind, they're saying I'm a bad person, right? And so there's this initial like, oh no, it must be you, or you must be misunderstanding, or you're being overly sensitive, right? That's kind of the initial reaction we typically see, because again, it's hard to think of ourselves in a way that might not be in a positive light. But what we're gonna try to do is recognize that everyone here has probably experienced microaggressions, and everyone has probably microaggressed somebody at some point, because we're talking about this in a racial context, but we also have to recognize that there's microaggressions based upon gender, based upon class, based upon sexual orientation, based upon any other intersection that you can actually think of. So it's a normal part of our lives, right? But of course, in the context of our conversation today, and the work that Dr. Harris and I do on men of color, race is front and center. And we have to think about how are those messages even more pervasive based upon a person's racial and ethnic background. The other thing to say here is that microaggressions are shown to have significant negative effects on student success. It affects students' trust, their perception of belonging. It has an effect on their non-cognitive outcomes, in particular their self-esteem and their self-efficacy, their confidence and their ability academically and in just a personal self-efficacy as well. So we know that it has negative effects on success, and of course all those things lead to what? You know, those things affect student success, and so we have to keep that in mind. And then we also have to recognize that everyone, again, perpetuates microaggressions at some point because we're all exposed to the same societal conditions. We're all socialized to perceive people of color in the same way, right? And so it's difficult to separate yourself from that socialization process, right? And what we can do, though, is we can become more cognizant about the words that we say. We can gain a greater self-awareness and understanding of others and use that to curb the microaggressions that we essentially portray on other people or do to other people or aggress on other people. But at the same time, recognizing that there's, you know, we still have to be vigilant. We might still do it. But if we recognize that we're doing it midstream, we can say, hey, you know what, I'm sorry, I just recognized that I might have said this to you. Let me take ownership for that, and then let's move forward, right? The other piece here that we also need to recognize that, again, all minoritized groups experience microaggressions, right? But of course, our work, we're really focused on men of color. All right, so it's not just the microaggression itself, right? Because it's actually the message that's the underlying message that's interpreted from the person who receives the actual microaggression. So I say something to you, right? And we're talking about this all in abstract because I haven't provided any examples of microaggressions, right? But I say something to you, I microaggress you, right? You receive a message, right, from that. And here's some common underlying messages that are received. And I think it's important to focus on these because we're going to do an exercise at the end. And you'll want to have thought about different underlying messages that are being communicated. One message that's common is that you're different from us, right? You're different from us, or you don't belong here. In fact, with the men of color and the work that we've done, as some of the most common microaggressions we see deal with a perception that you don't belong here, you're different from us, you're not good enough, right? Which it kind of goes into the next one, perceptions that you're not intelligent or capable. That people of color are lazy and don't care. That your experience and perception is wrong, are wrong. You're being too sensitive. For men of color, these next two are particularly relevant. You're a criminal or you're dangerous, right? Or racism doesn't exist. So there's underlying messages, and then those messages become internalized, right, by the person who receives them. And over time, right, it has a negative effect. Now, what I usually do when we present this is we usually actually start out with some examples in K-12, right? Because it's easier for people to see examples that deal with somebody else, right? And then we can start to think about seeing ourselves in it. But I would stop to say that microaggressions begin very early on. The messages that students receive as preschoolers, right, serve to begin to shape their perceptions of school from a very, very early age. How many folks remember several years ago when there was a picture of a group of students in school, right? And it was like a class picture, and all the students were sitting in one place, and then there was a student who had a disability who was in a wheelchair, and they were sitting like 3 feet far away from everyone in the class in the class picture. That's an example of a microaggression, right? It's a communicating to a person that you really don't belong, but you're not one of us. It became a big national story, and in fact, what they did is they actually had the class retake the picture because the school got so much heat for it. I look at the messages that are said to my own son, who's in preschool, right, by his teachers, right, that like he says something that's intelligent, they're like, oh, wow, that's good, right? that look of surprise on their face communicates to him a message, an underlying message, that they didn't think that he would be able to do those things, right? And so we can't just view this in the context of just this happens in college, right? This is something that happens throughout a person's life. So that when they hear these things in college, they're not filtering it through that single experience. They're filtering it through all those experiences that they've had that have led up to that moment, right? Which makes it then even more powerful, the negative effect of it. So three different types of microaggressions have been articulated in the literature. How many people have read Microaggressions in Everyday Life by Sue and colleagues? All right. It is one person, Gassim, read it. Okay. I encourage everyone to go and read this. It, actually, you can see the citation here at the bottom, and we're going to make the slides available to everyone, right? This is an incredible piece. It talks about the different types of microaggressions there are, and most importantly, talks about the message that's interpreted by the people who receive them, right? And I think it's a good way for us to help understand like what exactly is being interpreted when we do these, when we microaggress people. But in the article, basically, they say that there's three main types of microaggressions. There's microassaults, microinsults, and microinvalidations. So a microassault, as you can see here, is an explicit racial derogation characterized primarily by a violent verbal or nonverbal attack. So when we think about microassaults, we're really actually thinking about things that actually aren't so subtle. This is kind of more the traditional racism. This is racial epithets, calling a person of color colored, calling a someone the N-word or other kind of language. I know for myself, I grew up in a predominantly white town in the far, far northern California, and on a regular basis, and growing up, I was referred to as cottonhead or niggling, right? Those were like things I was so commonly referred to that I recognized that this is how people perceive me, right? So when we think about these microassaults, they're very direct examples of racism. It's when people say nasty jokes, right? Or tell people, don't talk to that person because they're black. Or don't talk to that person because they're Latino, right? So we're not going to spend a lot of time on that because I think everybody has a good understanding of what a microassault is, right? All right? And if not, come see me afterwards. I can give you some good examples. All right. But what we are going to spend our time doing is talking about microinsults and microinvalidations. Why? Because these are the two that happen, I would argue, most often. And and you'll see that for a microinsult, it's often unconscious. Microinvalidations are often conscious, but can also be unconscious, right? And so these are things that sometimes people aren't even aware that they're saying these things to people and hurting people in very deep ways. So just really quick, looking at the actual definitions. So a microinsult is a behavioral, verbal remark or comment that conveys rudeness, insensitivity, and this last piece is key, and demeans a person, right? Versus microinvalidation, basically you're negating, you're excluding, or you're nullifying the experiences and realities of people, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to explore now different types of microinsults and microinvalidations. And again, with this whole piece with critical race theory, we want to name things, right? So you'll see that there's names for each of these different types. Now, there'll be examples that we'll present that really could actually span multiple different categories at the same time, right? And so what we want you to do as you see these examples is not just look at the example, but think about what is the message that's being received by the person who this is said to. So, ascription of intelligence. Here are some things that are examples of microaggressions that deal with ascription of intelligence. And you can see the definition for it, assigning a degree of intelligence to a person of color based upon their race. So, how many people have heard someone say to a person of color, you're so articulate? How many people in this room have had someone say that to you? But not in a way where it was necessarily something that it was a compliment, but something that was like, I was surprised that you were so articulate. Anybody? No? So, when someone says you're so articulate, what could be the actual message that's received?
I wasn't expecting you to be so articulate.
I wasn't expecting you to be so articulate, right? So we have to think about, again, when we say things to people, what is actually being received by them? Wow, you're so smart. Right? Those are another way of saying the same thing. Another example of this would be asking for math help from an Asian person, right? Assuming that what? That because they're Asian American, they're going to be good at math, right? So assigning essentially based upon someone's background, saying to a black person, you're a science major? Actually, one of the study that we pulled out from was actually based upon, black students who were in STEM, and these were things that were actually said to them by both other students in the class as well as their faculty members. When they came in, they're like, oh, you're a science major? Are you sure you're in the right class? Right? And so, in the faculty member's mind, what they were trying to do is, oh, this person must be in the wrong place. Let me help them get to where they need to be going. Right? But in reality, let's say to the student, what? You're not meant to be here. Right? So we have to think about what are those kind of reactions that people might have. Students not wanting to work with a person of color because they're perceived as being dumb. Actually, when we look at the data for men of color, this is actually probably the example that we see most often, right? Where they talk about how they'll be in class, and there'll be other students who are in the class, and they'll be breaking up into groups, and the groups are voluntary, like, hey, you choose your own group, and they're the last one to get picked, or people don't want to work with them, or, you know, people avoid eye contact with them so they can go work with someone else. And the feeling that they have that comes from that is, wow, they really think I'm dumb, right? And of course, a message like that has to be filtered through their entire experience, right? As a person of color, where they've been told that they're unintelligent, they're not good enough, the school's not for them, that they should be doing anything else other than being in school. Here's an example of that. And these are, one is from a focus group we conducted, and two others are from a research study that was done by Daniel Salvazzano, who's one of the premier researchers on critical race theory. So here would be one that we have from our focus group, right? And these focus groups are done at campuses all over the place around the country, right? So when we would have group projects, I'd be the last person picked because they assume that I don't know as much as they do. Here's one from Salzano's study. A black male student thought he was going to be pre-med, and he was in the chemistry lab, and nobody wanted him to be in their work group. So his partner turned out to be this deaf girl. I'm sure everybody looked at him like they're never going to pass, right? There's two different microaggressions that are tied up in that one, right? That's not one that just deals with race. That one also deals with ability status, right? Here's another one. In a technical field, as an engineer, sometimes you'll feel like other students don't want to approach black students for their groups, especially when they think the blacks are just not technically smart, as maybe an Asian. And I'll notice they'll make some study groups, and maybe you'll be the last one asked. So you feel more of a need to establish yourself. You need to prove yourself, right? Those are examples of that. Another one that we see pretty often is what's called a second-class citizen, right? And this is basically being treated as lesser than and people overlooking you, right? So, and we have examples from all different sectors. So, you know, here we go. Person of color being mistaken for a service worker. We've interviewed men of color who've been asked on campus, you know, hey, where do I find this or find that? Assuming that they were groundskeepers, maintenance workers. And so that's something that we want to keep in mind. This is one that I've experienced pretty often, especially when I was in New York. Maybe it was just New York. I don't know. But they said, you know, was having a taxi cab basically passed me up for other people who were white, right? Or being ignored at a store counter for a white customer. Or being ignored in financial aid, right, for a person of color, right? Or any other student service on campus, right? We know that people of color experience these incidents on a regular basis, right? Where they're treated as if they are invisible, like they're not there, right? And then oftentimes, from my own experience, because I've experienced this a lot, is when this occurs and you call someone out on it, right? The first thing to say, oh, well, I didn't realize that you were in line because you looked like you were doing something else. It's like, what do you mean I looked like I was doing something else? I was standing right here with all my stuff, right in front of you, right? But they passed you up for someone else. And just think about the message that would be communicated from that, right, and how that would be received by a student, right? So let's talk about this in a classroom context, right? What would this look like in a classroom context? Anybody? If people raise their hand, what would happen?
So we choose one student over another.
Okay, right? And as faculty members, like, we have our go-to students, right? Our go-to students are typically those ones who are, like, the most vocal in class and contribute the most, right? They're our go-to students because we know we can go to them when we need somebody else to kind of speak up, right? And so sometimes we rely upon them, right? And there might be another student who's raising their hand, but we go to our go-to student, right? Because it's comfortable, right? Well, what would be another example of this? I'm thinking about, like, before, after class, right? Faculty member, there's students, right, who are standing in line trying to talk to the faculty, right? And they, and there's several students there, and who's the first person they go to, right? It depends, right? But it's something we need to be cognizant of and think about. Pathologizing culture and values, right? The notion that values and communication styles of people of color are abnormal or lowly, right? So asking a person of color, black person in particular, why do you have to be so loud? Asking an Asian person, why are you so quiet? These are clear examples of really pathologizing perceived communication and culture, right? But in a college context, I think that the one we see about this that's most clear is when they say to people, these people don't care, these students don't care. Why aren't they trying hard enough? They don't care. Why are they even here? They don't even want to be here, right? We pathologize them and their values and assume that it's a person of color, right? It's a black student, so do they really, really want to be here and do this, right? And here's the thing that we know about this, right? Let's just say that you have a black male student in class who might be apprehensive to engage in that classroom, right? So a faculty member sees that student, and they say, they don't care. These people don't care, right? Their community, right? Don't care. Without really taking into account the numerous experiences they've had up until that point that have told them that they shouldn't engage in that classroom, where they've been never actually made feel welcome to do so. And we did a study where we did interviews with black men in community colleges, and one of the things that came out was that basically they were apprehensive to engage in class. Some of you may have heard us say this before, because they were worried that the faculty member would see them as dumb, ignorant, stupid, and they used a whole bunch of other words to describe it. So they would say to us, like, hey, that faculty member, you know, they would ask somebody, do you know the answer to this question? I'd know the answer, but I wouldn't say anything. Or they would say, does anybody need any help? Like, anybody have any questions? And I really actually needed to ask something, but I wouldn't do so, right? Because why? I thought they would think I'm dumb, I'm ignorant, I'm stupid, right? But then a faculty member might say and see these people and say, well, they don't care, right? Making assumptions. Here's some examples. The stereotype for Latinos is we don't care about school. Right, so that's like the stereotype for us, right? When I go to class, I feel the pressure to have to prove myself to the professor that I want to learn, instead of the professor having an open mind to the fact that I do want to learn. There's this stigma that students of color don't want to learn. I've been in class where professors think, I don't want to learn. It's the same message that we see over and over and over and over again from the students when we talk. Same message. Assumption of criminality. For black men and other men of color, we know that this is true. We can look across the country and see high-profile slayings of black men. Tamir Rice, Trayvon Martin, Michael Brown. We can go on down the line and see all these examples of how basically black men are treated as criminals in the street. And oftentimes they're treated as criminals on campus as well, because it's not some magic barrier that that says, okay, we're going to treat them this way outside of college, but then when they get here, we're going to treat them differently. No, we see the same kind of patterns. We see faculty members who don't want to meet with a student one-on-one in their office because they're fearful that he might attack me. Or I don't want to talk to the student at nighttime on campus because I think that he might be up to no good. I don't know what he's doing, right? So we can see examples that where they are presumed to be criminal, dangerous, or deviant. And this is not just with our work, we've seen other works. In fact, there was a great report that was done by the MDRC. They did interviews, or actually focus groups, with a whole bunch of men of color from different ethnic groups. And one of the common things that they found is that they were perceived by their faculty as thugs. So an example would be a white woman clutching her purse as she walks by a black or Latino. A store owner following a customer of color around the store. Or a person on campus following a person of color around the bookstore, right? or a person waiting for the next elevator to avoid a person of color, right? We can think of other examples of how this might come into play. So let's stop for a second, because this is a really important piece, because this is one of the most salient themes that we see. Assumption of criminality. How do you think that might be manifested on college settings for black men and other men of color? Black and Latino men in particular, in this context. Any examples that you've seen where they've been perceived or treated as criminals? Yes.
I know in SCSU campus there's a lot of alerts all the time in the description of men of color wearing basketball shorts, and they're constantly stopped to check if they fit the description.
Yep, absolutely. Any other examples? Yes.
Sometimes in the parking lot where somebody might be driving a nice car and it's assumed that it's not theirs.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yes.
Perhaps when you're looking at students during the test to see who's cheating, you can make assumptions about who's cheating.
That is a great example, and we'll use that to go to the next to the example on the board. That's great. Great one. So I was doing really well in class. Like, math is one of my strong suits. We took a quiz and I got like a 95. The professor was like, come to my office, we need to talk. And I was like, okay. I just really knew I was going to be told, great job. But he said, we think you've cheated. We just don't know, so we think we're going to make you retake the exam again. And I took it, and with a graduate student instructor in the room, and just myself, and I got a 98 on the exam. Right? Actually, this exact example happened to my twin brother when we were in college, where he aced an exam in Spanish. And they accused him of cheating and asked him to retake the exam in a very similar situation. He scored really high. And then so the faculty member was mad, right, that he scored high and gave him an F in the class. All right, different Nomi, right? This one occurs, like, at least in my experience, when you're with people, maybe you're with people who are white, or of majority group of any different context, right? And like, they start becoming a little bit too comfortable with you, and they say something about other people, like, oh, those black people are this, right? And then they recognize for a second, oh man, I just said that from this person. Well, when I was talking about those blacks, I wasn't really talking about you. You're different, right? We refer to that as different norming, right? When basically you try to exceptionalize one person and denigrate essentially the community that they come from. You're not like the rest of them, you're different. If there was only more of them like you, I don't think of you as black, right? These are common examples of that. Okay, so we just went through some examples of micro insults. Now we're gonna do some examples of micro invalidations. But before we go any further, any reflections upon like some of the information that you're hearing?
I can look back at my own past, and I just, the weight of it, just, it's so heavy. And I know you talk about how you bring that into the classroom environment and how it impacts success. And so I just wanted, you know, to have that part of the conversation, because it's heavy. And you can think about all of these things, and I sit here and I'm thinking, I can go through, you know what I mean, some of the things that happened just yesterday, going to the mall, or it's so...
This is a daily experience.
It is a daily experience.
It starts early on, yeah. In fact, when you say that, it actually brings one example to my mind with my daughter, where they had, at her preschool, they had a play that they were doing. It was Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And there was one white girl who was in her classroom, and the rest of the class was students of color. And who do you think was Snow White? Right? And like, the primary line in the play is her ordering the rest of them, who are basically supposed to be dwarves and animals, around, saying, you wipe the kitchen, you clean the floors, you do the dishes, right? And I just sat back and I was just like, should I say anything, right? And it's like one of those things, like, they're constantly reinforcing messages like that so early on.
No, I was thinking also about my kids. You know, sometimes it's so hard to see it, because they're so subtle sometimes that you don't really know which way it goes, but the fact that they speak Spanish is almost a negative. rather than a positive. So yeah. Being bilingual, when other kids is like, well, you speak Spanish, like, is something wrong with them? And because of that, they actually are very nervous of speaking Spanish. They rather hide that side of that part of themselves when they are in their school community. And of course, here I am going the opposite, but telling them, no, you have to be proud of it. But it's those messages that almost make them feel embarrassed for their own, you know, culture. So yeah, I thought that might be something similar. But I have a question too. I know this is more towards, you know, minorities, but could it happen also the other way around?
Going back to Luke's earlier point, right, that when we're talking about microaggressions, they're not, you know, it's not, they're not sort of contextualized with just minority sort of as the targets, right? We gotta think about gender microaggressions, people with disabilities are microaggressed. People are microaggressed based on their sexual identity or sexual orientation. So I would say, you know, by definition, yeah, you know, a person of color could, you know, a white person could be the target of a racial microaggression from a person of color.
I think what we have to recognize, though, is that while that probably can occur and does occur, that the microaggressions that probably have the most deleterious effect on psychological health are those that are the most common. And the ones that we know, based upon extensive research, are most common are those that are directed from one group to another, typically toward the minority group. Yes?
So I went to a deaf school, and all the teachers there were hearing. And my mother said when I went into school that the behavior changed, because the school, the teachers, they were all hearing, so my behavior at home was different compared to my experience growing up. And so I felt that oppression right there because of all the teachers being hearing. So it was just like that for me as well. I didn't feel good about myself because the teachers, I felt like, you know, I'm smart and I'm deaf and I can, but the teachers, I didn't feel the support. You know, I felt like, you know, that there wasn't enough support because of just being deaf.
And how do you think they received you?
That as not being intelligent, because I couldn't speak, I don't voice, I don't talk. So they were like, you're not hearing enough.
So then, that's the microaggression, that's the message that's received. Now what was the effect? How did that make you feel? Did that make you more engaged in school? Did that increase your confidence? Or did it hurt?
It depended on the situation. Sometimes I was more quiet, and sometimes if I was angry, I was more aggressive. Motivated for school.
Thanks for sharing. Okay, we're going to go through some other examples of micro-invalidations, and then once we get to the end here, we got some examples for you, and what we're going to have you do is help us classify what type of microaggression is this, and then what's the underlying message that's received. Okay? So, alien in the homeland, and we added in college in this one. Okay? So this goes to what I think what Maria was about to say. Basically, this is one, in the research on microaggressions, it's actually just really alien and on land, right? Where it's basically saying that the people who are visible minorities are perceived as foreigners, right? But in the work that we do, we recognize that people who are people of color are perceived as foreigners in college, meaning people who don't belong here at this institution. You're an outsider, you're an other. And so we felt like that's really kind of getting at the same underlying theme. So examples would be someone saying to someone, you know, where are you from, where were you born, assuming that because they're a person of color that they weren't born here or from here. Which is, of course, I'm sure awkward when they say, I was born and raised in San Diego, where are you from, right? So, or you speak good English, right? That's interesting, thanks, so do you. You know, that's typically when people say, actually, that's kind of actually my strategy. Whenever people microaggress me, I kind of say it right back to them, because I think it helps them to think about what they just said. I don't know if that would be a recommended strategy, but it's just what I do. Can you teach me a word in Spanish because the person's Latino? Well, maybe they don't speak Spanish, right? We shouldn't make that assumption. And assuming that people of color don't belong in academic spaces, right? So here's an example of that, from Salazano's work. Last time we went to the library to study, obviously it's firehouse time. People are going to study. But when we walked in there looking for someone to sit down, it's like they've never seen a black person before, people before in the lives, or they've never seen black people study before. And they were talking about in this piece how they looked at them like, you don't belong here, what are you doing here? And it made them feel like, man, maybe we should just go someplace else. Because everybody turned up looking at them like, what are they doing here? Colorblindness is another example of microaggression, right? And this is denial or pretense that a white person does not see color or race. When I look at you, I don't see color. America's the melting pot. There's only one race, the human race. We're all human. We're all the same. How many people have heard this message before? Right? What? Okay. So that's what's being said. What is being received by a person of color when they hear that? What is possibly being received?
It's almost like taking away their history.
Yeah. It's taking away, no, go articulate.
Their history, their identity, I mean, you know, their heritage and everything. Like, we're part of the same dominant history where we're not. So there is much more into ourselves than just all being the same at certain levels.
Yeah.
We see this a lot with the Black Lives Matter.
Ooh.
Right.
Ooh. Yeah. Get them.
Sort of the you know, the pushback there is all lives matter, right? Like, why are we so emphasizing, well, like, Black Lives Matter?
But what would be wrong with saying that?
What would be wrong with saying that?
All lives matter.
Well, nothing, but when the whole point of the Black Lives Matter movement is to you know, raise consciousness and highlight some of the things you mentioned earlier about these public and high-profile slayings of black people with no accountability, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think the pushback in response to the pushback has been, yeah, all lives matter, but it's not all lives that are being sort of, you know, taken and treated and targeted in a callous way.
Agree. Yes.
It suggests that racism is not an active issue. It kind of suggests we don't have a problem anymore because we've all blended. And so it invalidates this critical approach to race.
Okay, so now we talked about what's being received, right? What do you think the person saying it means? And of course, there can be different meanings about what they're actually saying. What do you think that they're intending to say?
I don't know. This is a hard one for me because where I'm putting myself out there a little bit, I feel like it. Because I say my basis starts from that we are all human and that we all should be treated like we're human, and that's a starting point. And then our own identities and our own experiences make who we are, and we go from there. But that's kind of like one of the basis for who I am and how I live my life, is that we're all human to start. But again, from there, it builds with our individuality. So. But that's
when I say that, you say we're all human, but I recognize your individuality is important. You say that is all one line.
It always comes together because it can't be separate. It's separated, and it's because we each have unique experiences that make who we are, cultural, race, and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
But I know at the base, we're all humans and living organisms that need each other. But that's when I talk about it, that's what I talk about. But I know it comes across. And maybe it does. I don't know. It's a struggle for me.
Okay. We're going to go here and then over here.
Well, I was going to say, I think it's the dominant, like the white person kind of going, what are you so worried about? Kind of marginalizing them and saying, just immediately invalidating them, marginalizing, cutting them off, not letting them experience what they're experiencing and work through that. Just you're done. Cut them off completely and totally disrespect their dignity as a human being. But I think that's kind of what you're saying. It's like each person has dignity, so we have to recognize that, but each person has a different experience too.
I think that both of those examples sort of point out the importance of context too for how these kinds of words are received. And so if you're just having a conversation about what matters about human beings, and there probably are many individuals who can forget about color in many of their circumstances where they are interacting with a diverse group of people. But if you have a conversation where somebody is actually telling you about their experience with racism or with color or something, and you say, well, when I look at people, I don't see color. That's very different, I think, that this, whether you're denying somebody's experience or the fact of racism as a problem versus your own, like, I'm trying to see people as human beings and not treat people differently on the basis of color. Those are really different, but the words can be the same.
You know what this reminds me of is one of the tenets that we talk about in the core training that's been opened up to your campus, and we're really glad to have you all on board with that. And one of the first things that we talk about is that everyone, all teachers can teach men of color. You don't have to be a person of color to teach men of color, but you do have to teach them as men of color. You do have to recognize the unique experience that they have, the unique challenges, but the unique assets as well. And I think that this kind of gets even a little bit at that in terms of how faculty members, it may be easier to just say, I don't see everything, everybody's the same. But if you don't recognize the individuality and the unique beauty, really, that everyone brings, then you're missing out on such an important aspect of who they are. And you're also letting go of factors that you can really then leverage in your relationships with them to, you know, create better success.
I'm sorry, too. A good example, too, is you see, like, the TV performance of America's Next Top Model. You've seen that? America's Next Top Model. There's a deaf person there right now, and now it's the oppression is still there, too. The deaf person is there, he's present, but it's like black people go through the same thing as far as the oppression that they experience here at school. Let's voice something. So again, the oppression is still here, it's present. You know, so that show, America's Next Top Model, I don't know if any of you watch it, but there's a deaf person participating in that right now. Did you know that? A lot of people don't know it, but people in that community, they know it, but they often forget. You know, on the show, they talk, and they forget that he's here. He's dismissed. And so it's just a way of being oppressed, just because they have to go on because their group is already communicating and speaking. They can't just stop thing everything just for his needs.
So they treat everyone the same, and as a result, they marginalize this person from this perspective that I'm colorblind or I'm ability blind. Yeah.
Yes.
Dr. Harris?
Exactly.
Three really quick points here related to colorblindness. I think we have to understand that being able to have a colorblind perspective on race is a privilege, right? So you know, for like, that's not a privilege that as a person of color that I could ever exercise, right? That I don't get the opportunity to opt out about race or sort of put my race in the back burner at any point, because it's very salient in my lived experiences, right? For a lot of the things that you talked about earlier. I think the second point is that when we sort of have this colorblind perspective, we ignore or overlook the realities of race for students, right? So when we say, I don't see race, I don't see color, it's not important. Well, it's very important and very salient in my lived experience. So, you know, to deny that and to not recognize that is marginalizing. And then I think the third point is that when we have a colorblind perspective, particularly in classrooms, then it can help us miss the incredible learning opportunities that are available when we have a diverse setting, a diverse classroom, right? Diverse with regard to race and diverse with regard to other aspects as well. But, you know, if I have a diverse class and I have students that are bringing all these different experiences and backgrounds and perspectives, I need to see that as an opportunity to teach. I need to see that as an asset in my class. If I have a colorblind perspective, I'm not going to recognize that, and I'm not going to capitalize and take the opportunity to capitalize on those assets that students bring. So, three things I would say about
that. I had one thing here.
Okay, no, go ahead. You're in there.
Okay, no, I'm glad Leslie brought that up about the gentleman on America's Top Model, because I've been watching that show because it's scholarly and everything. But I have been watching the show, and one of the things that Frank brought up and I heard from Leslie is this is, and it was a teaching opportunity, because the deaf model, they did a little experiment, and they went through like a whole hour where nobody was allowed to talk, and they had interpreters to help sign, and they all were able to reflect on how he must have felt. So they said, oh yeah, we can relate to your struggle, ABC, and then within an hour, they were all reacting the way they always did. Right. So it's just like we're attending this session today, and everybody's aware and cognizant of everything we're talking about. And we're having a wonderful diversity event for, you know, Cultural Awareness Week. And then the next week, everybody's right back to where they were in square one. So that was a really, to me, a really critical point that he made through his experience. And even though he's doing really well, I mean, he's out modeling them, and he's showing them that even though he can't talk, he still got the qualities that they're looking for. But even through that experiment, as soon as it was over, they all went back to excluding him. He feels excluded from a lot of the conversations that they have.
So like, I mean, that's right. That's ability privilege, right? So the models who weren't deaf, yeah, they got to sort of perhaps walk a mile in his shoes for an hour. But because, you know, because they are hearing, it was a privilege for them to be able to say, okay, I'm done with this for an hour. It's a privilege that he's not afforded, you know. And we see the same thing with regard to race, right? He doesn't get to opt out of being deaf. You know, a person of color doesn't get to ever opt out of being a person of color. Or opt in, right? I mean, it's at the core of your lived experience.
Okay, so here, this is just an example of this, and I think that has helped me tremendously because, you know, when I grew up, we didn't see color. This is just an example of an interview with a faculty member who perceived themselves as being culturally competent, and that was how they referred to other individuals. Okay, myth and meritocracy, this is one that I think we really see this one when we do hiring, right? I believe the most qualified person should get the job, right? I sat on when I was at my first institution, which was in Tennessee, they immediately put me on the diversity committee. I think they figured, oh, well, he's African American, he should be on the diversity committee.
Which is a microaggression in and of itself.
Which was a microaggression in and of itself, yeah. And believe me, how they conveyed it to me made me feel very microaggressed. but then the diversity committee was given the role of trying to take up hiring, right? And talk a little bit about hiring. Now, I don't know how some of these people got on the committee, because they clearly weren't people who had any interest in diversity. But one of the things that came out of the conversations was, you know, well, the dean wants us to hire more faculty of color, right? You know, understand though, at that time, I was the only faculty of color in the College of Education at that time, right? So then the next thing that was said was, well, we need to think about quality. I mean, if we're going to go out and hire all these people of color, what are we doing about quality? I'm like sitting there right there, like, oh, dang, what am I, chopped liver? You know, right? But that's kind of where we see this context most, is like this idea that the people who are the best get things, as opposed to what we really know, oftentimes in hiring, it's because you know somebody, right? And that's oftentimes how things take place, right? But we don't like to say that. What we like to say is, well, they weren't qualified, right? So, and here's another example. Everyone can succeed in this society if they work hard enough. And here's an example from that. And this is from one of our doctoral students. She's doing a study on trans-border students. And here's a quote from one of the students in her study. There was always pointing the fingers at the Mexican people. For example, if there were scholarships available, they would always say Mexicans taking advantage of that opportunity. But I don't see it like that. I mean, if there are opportunities out there, why not take them? And the perception that they were talking about in this specific study was, well, they thought that we were getting these things undue because we were Mexicans, but in reality, we were applying for the scholarship and we were getting the opportunity. But it's a perception that the people who really deserved the scholarship, the people who were the most qualified, the white students, weren't getting the scholarships. And that was the context of that study. Denial of individual racism. I'm not racist, I voted for Obama. Anybody ever someone said that?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, we've got a couple hands raising up. I'm not racist, I have several black friends.
Oh yeah.
Right? As a woman, I know what you go through. Right? So these are just examples. Come on, there's no more racism, we have a black president. So these are just examples of the same thing, right? But really what it's talking about is when we deny someone's individual racism. So Frank shares with me an experience that he has, right, where he is on the plane and he's told something that no one else is told, like, you know, we want to make, you know, are you okay? Because for some reason they're worried about him and not about anybody else in the plane, right? He's microaggressed in some way. If I'm Frank's friend and Frank tells me this, and my immediate thing is, man, that didn't happen, or you're being too sensitive, or you're overplaying this, right? What am I doing? I'm denying the individual experience that he just had, right? And his experience is his reality, right? And so that's important for us to keep in mind. Invisibility. This is a very common one. Calling black females by other black females' names, or black males by other black males' names. Terrence, right?
Frank.
I always get you guys mixed up. You look so similar. You know what, you wanna hear something funny? I can't tell you how often we've gotten mixed up, and let's just say that we don't look anything alike. handing homework or assignments back to the wrong person of color, right? A faculty member walking by a black person on campus without acknowledging their presence, that should be fine. So here's, I guess I took out the example of that, but we had an example where people, many of the students we have talk about these instances where they just didn't even know who they were, right? Faculty members in their class, right? Now, in some cases, if you've got a lecture hall of 300 students, you're probably not gonna know everybody. But if you're in a small classroom, right, you should probably, you know, several months in, be able to generally have an idea of somebody's name, right? Or be able to fake it good enough so that they think you know their name. But we have to really think about these things and the messages being received.
I just want to say, I went to University of San Diego back in the 2000s. Anyhow, there were probably about 5 black females there. And we would, our instructors would get us mixed up even by semesters. Like a whole semester will pass and they'll be like, oh, are you Ebony? Are you Rasha? I experienced that so much in my undergrad years. I just want to say that I can identify with being called some of my other friends at school, their names all the time.
Great. So what was the message that was received?
That we are, and maybe we were together all the time. Who knows? We probably were. But anyhow, that we were one. That whatever, the 5 black girls that, you know, came through this class, that we were all grouped together as like one black girl. I was Rasha, Ebony, Tiffany. You know, I was that one person. So there was the perception that we all thought the same, we all had the same ideas, that we, you know, that somehow we were the same person.
This is not an academic one, but this just happened recently. We were at a restaurant. You know, sometimes they'll come around and take pictures of your family and then they'll show you pictures. Oh. So it was my husband, myself, and my daughter, right? And so we're in a restaurant, and we notice if you go in a restaurant, what the diversity looks like who's in a restaurant. And so when they came to bring us our pictures, it was not even us. It was the other.
Was that Book of the Beppo?
No, it was not. He was embarrassed, but it was just so interesting that you just saw it and you just didn't even think to see us, that you just saw black, and these must be your pictures. It was just, okay, thanks.
So what we're going to do, collectively, we're going to look at different examples. We're going to identify the type of microaggression it is, recognizing that it could actually be multiple microaggressions in the same instance, right? We can really microaggress people if we want. And then we're going to talk about what is the message that is received from the person when this is said to them, okay? So there we go. Here's the first one. So this is from an M2C3 focus group. All right. I'm going to take more of a personal standpoint, looking from inside out. Appearance. How I look towards a classmate, teachers. Asking too many questions. That right there have been a huge challenge. There have been times when I've answered a question and then I get a response like, wow, I didn't expect you to know that. Okay.
Microinsults.
All right, I hear a few different ones in here. So let's go here, here, and then here. So yeah, I think you
yeah, it's a description of intelligence.
Okay. And what is the message that's being received by the student?
I didn't expect you to know that, but that, wow, you're actually smart.
Meaning that they thought that they were?
They were dumb. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, they assumed that they were dumb.
All right, go ahead.
Well, I said alien on land because they belong on campus, right? But kind of saying I didn't think you expected that. I mean, I agree with the description of intelligence too, that's number one, but I kind of feel like it's kind of saying you don't belong here in a way. Mm-hmm. Like, I didn't think you belonged.
Yeah.
But now maybe you do. You know?
Definitely. And then Charlotta?
Oh, I thought you wanted us to name the type of microaggression, so I said it was the micro insult.
Okay, that works too. All right, here we go. Here's another one. I think that one of the groups was obviously athletes, right? So this is an interview with a faculty member. It wasn't completely an African-American. It was kind of a mix, but they were all seemed to be wearing the same, whatever the college's name, athletic wear. That was one of the reasons we ended up having to lock the group study rooms, because then unfortunately on the quiet side of the library, they were using, and this was also didn't help the fact that this is when they were redoing the cafeteria. There was no social space on campus. It was the beginning of school. August here, which is our beginning, is a very miserable sort of month. We are air conditioned. You don't have to swipe your ID to get in, so it was an easy place to hang out. But they were literally having, food parties in there with lots of food and drink. And fortunately, it wasn't the sort of drink that was just non-water drinks. But that was really frustrating for us as a department. It also created, I felt like it created a lot of attention. This one's supposed to be harder. Go ahead.
Assumption of criminality, almost. Like something bad is going to happen.
Like they're deviant,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
So we could all definitely say that there's an assumption that they were up to doing something they should have been doing, right? I think that's definitely one. I think I saw a hand over here. I don't remember. No?
Well, I think second class citizens, right?
Second class citizen? Why is that?
Well, because they didn't belong there, sounds like you're saying.
I think, for me personally, I see it almost as pathologizing culture,
yeah.
Right? I think that one of the things that's being communicated here is that they're up to no good because they're having, they're using this as a social time, right? Whereas, I think if you were to look at the rest of this interview, you would recognize that they had absolutely no idea what this person was actually doing, what these students were actually doing. It was just this perception that they're in a group. They have food, they must be doing something. Okay, here's another one.
With this one, the previous one, you see this one. On many campuses, there'll be spaces where students of color sort of kind of congregate. You know, perhaps like out in the yard or in the quad, and that, you know, sometimes those spaces become kind of looked at in a real suspect way, you know, by the folks on campus. Oh, that's the, you know, that's where the Latino kids hang out, or that's little this or little that, which is sort of along the same line.
Yeah, definitely.
Can I have an example? When I was in a graduate program, not yours, but it's a master level work, you had group discussions, and they would have these cultural plunges, and sometimes they would do these dialogues, and so African American students would sit in the center, and we would have a dialogue about issues. And so, you know, we were having a conversation, you know, the voices, the tones were engaging, and someone, another student, made the assumption that, are you guys getting ready to fight? I'm sitting here like, what? First of all, we're sitting in a library, we're in graduate work, we are having a conversation, but because of the way that we were communicating, it was not threatening. Nobody felt threatened, but the notion was, I can't take this conversation. Are you guys getting ready to fight? And so, to me, that was just very interesting in a multicultural education counseling program that someone perceived the way that we are communicating as threatening without really listening to the actual discussion.
We were at a conference, and it was a colleague who worked at a community college in, I'll just say, in the Los Angeles area. And she said that there was a space where the black students on the campus, they hung out, they congregated, you know, they did whatever the students did in between classes and things like that. And the sheriff, like the campus police would like literally come and surround, like create a circle
like
around the group, like almost like a SWAT team or something.
Every day.
Yeah, every day.
On the same area and stand there to watch them.
Yeah. And the president of the college, you know, obviously wasn't too happy about it, but didn't have a whole lot of jurisdiction over, didn't have a whole lot of say, because I don't know what the relationship was between the college and law enforcement and the county or what it was, but it created a whole lot of tension and anxiety on campus.
Just a couple more. All right, here we go. They look at you and think, oh, that's another dumb black kid in class. That's how they make you feel. So you don't feel like saying, well, maybe this isn't me, because you second guess yourself. You're not saying that's a response. You second guess yourself. You're by yourself. If you have more African American students there, then there would be more of a voice besides your one single voice. Then you won't say, maybe I'm stupid. Maybe I just don't understand what's going on. What would this one be?
Alien.
Go ahead.
Alien.
Alien? Okay, how so?
Homeland.
How so?
They don't belong.
A perception that they don't belong? Okay, good. What else?
Second class citizen.
Second class citizen?
Treatment less than, but just another black person in class.
Got it. Anything else?
Description of an intelligence.
Yeah.
Because that's another dumb black in class.
Yeah. I was insane disability because they feel like nobody recognizes them.
Yeah. This is like a fourfold microaggression at once, right? So that's sometimes, unfortunately, what happens. So here's one, and this is from Walter Allen's work. She doesn't know my name. Like, just the other day, we were having a test review game, and I was, like, throwing popsicle sticks at the cup. And I'm like, you know, I'm the only black kid in your class next to three other black kids there. And I'm, like, one of the most goofiest ones there. And so she pulls my name out, and she goes, Daryl? And it's her own handwriting and everything. I'm like, come on, lady. I've been in your class now for 4 months now, and you don't know my name? She doesn't know me or anything like that. One of the things that you'll learn if you participate in the core training is like bare bottom, if you don't do anything else, know their name, right? Because personal relationships are a critical underpinning to any teaching that you're gonna do in the classroom. It really doesn't matter how good you teach if you don't have a relationship with them. All right, here's another one. I was in the department building, and I was walking down the hallway, and one of the teacher's doors was open. She's like, oh, I should have locked the door. My purse is in there. I was just thinking to myself, wow, maybe she should have kept that to herself or something, like, oh, I reminded you that you should lock your door. Assumption of criminality?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Last one, and then there are just some kind of concluding remarks. It's 11 o'clock at night, and all of a sudden, campus police swoops up. There's a total of 4 or 5 cars, and then we have 2 cop cars on bikes, all here for us, who are not displaying any type of violence or anything like that, but we're upset. And we're saying at the same time, we're feeling restricted because if we act in any way that we want to react, number one, we're going to go to jail. Number two, it's going to feed into the stereotype that we're supposed to be violent. We actually just stood there, out there for, and just really pleaded our case for at least a good 45 minutes. And they were not trying to hear us at all. We had to leave the parking lot. Once again, I'm reminded I'm a black man on a predominantly white campus. So these are just some examples that help you think about some of the interactions that you may have. You know, one of the things that we recognize when we do trainings like this is that oftentimes we're speaking with people like, you might not have known the term microaggression, but you probably recognize that most of these things were things that people shouldn't do. Might have some additional terminology that you didn't have before in terms of ways to kind of categorize it, right? But you may have already had somewhat of an awareness of some of this information, or most of this information, depending upon who you are. What is really important is thinking about what do you do from here, not just for yourself, but for other people, right? In our work, we classify essentially faculty members who participate in kind of what we call equity-based initiatives or equity-based training. Focus on developing the capacity to work with historically underrepresented and underserved students. We categorize them in a taxonomy in 4 different categories based upon their willingness to engage the efforts, number one, and number two, a knowledge of what to do. So the people who attend trainings like this are typically part of what we call the choir, right? The choir already knows what to do, and they already typically have a willingness to do it. Here you go, here's the taxonomy. Right? So they know what to do. And they have a willingness to employ those practices. They know what to do and they're willing. That's the choir. Right? Then we have people who are kind of like the secondary group of people who would attend something like this. Typically these are people where, you know, they're interested in doing these efforts. They have a willingness, right, to help other groups. They might not know exactly what to do. They recognize that maybe they need some training. And we refer to these people as they don't know what to do, but they have a willingness to do it. And these are what we refer to as, what do you think? Allies.
You want to go to the next slide?
Yeah. So we've got the choirs and the allies, right? in my mind, right, I'm making these percentages up, but I regularly ask people, what percentage do you think in terms of faculty fitting into these different categories, or educators in general? I think probably 10 to 15% are probably the choir, right? Maybe a little bit larger of a group are the allies, and then I think a large contingent of the faculty are actually in this category, right? These are people who don't know what to do and have an unwillingness to do it. We call this the don't know, don't care group, right? And these are the resistors. These are the people when there is an effort on campus to address, you know, issues for students with disabilities, to address racial issues on campus, who are going to attend a series that's being put on with something like this. These are the people who are like, I'm not going to that because, no, number one, I don't know what to do, and you know what, even if I did, I don't care. Right? So the don't know, don't care is troublesome because we can think about them in two different ways. One, there's the active resistors, right? Those who, when they hear that there's an event like this taking place, are like, you shouldn't go to that. That's racist. Why are they doing that? In fact, we've presented at campuses before where it was announced, it was an email sent out to campus, hey, Dr. Harrison Wood are going to be here to talk about men of color during convocation. And a faculty member responded to everyone on campus saying, I don't know why we're doing this. It's racist. We shouldn't be doing this. Why aren't we focused on white students? Why are we always focused on these students who don't care? I mean, it was like a rant. Actually, they sent three emails. The first one, after a while, I think their message kind of got lost as if people were like, oh my gosh, stop. But we have active resistors, and then we have those who are more passive, right? Those are the people who, I really don't want to do it, I don't care, but they may not be as passionate about it. And oftentimes when we think about what to do in terms of training, right, we say you start out with really here. You empower those who are in the choir, you educate the allies, and you encourage really those passive resistors, right, to care. And of course, for them, you have to recognize that if we're gonna do this, if we're gonna try to move an agenda forward on campus, we can't assume that the same arguments that work with these two groups work with this group. And the strategies are going to be different as well. With this group up here, a moral argument may be all you need. An opportunity to participate in an open flex may be all you need, right? But for this group, it takes more than that. There has to be some sort of incentive to do it. You have to expose them to the training with the hope that at the end of it, they'll care. So how do you get them to participate when they don't know and they don't care? Meaning you have to go to them. You have to think about what are ways that we can structure and embed this into things that they'll already be present at. And then of course there's the last group, and this is the defiant. The defiant are those who know what to do, and maybe they do it for everybody else, except for men of color, or students of color, students with disabilities, or low-income students, or whatever. Maybe they'll do it for certain students, right? So they know what to do. Maybe they've even received training, but they have an unwillingness to do it. And this is an example. I remember when I did my master's thesis, I interviewed a student who had participated in a class that was on, it was a K-12 class on Afrocentric pedagogy. And basically, at the end of the class, the student said, you know what? I've learned a lot in this class. I feel like I know what to do. I feel like I can employ the strategies. I feel like if I did it, they would work. And just to be honest, I'm not going to do it because I just don't believe in it, right? And so when you hear this, those are examples of people who are part of that kind of more defiant group. So what do you do with them? Well, I think you focus on these people. And if you ever get to the point where you have all the resistors on board, then you can worry about the defiant. But that's how we like to think about it, and that's how we try to think about moving forward an equity agenda on campus.
Really quickly, with the bottom group, how might interest convergence be employed as a strategy?
So with interest convergence, basically what it is, it's actually one of the things I glossed over with critical race here. In fact, I didn't talk about the slide. It's one of the core tenets. It basically suggests that any advances that are seen for people of color or minorities in society are only occur when their interests align with those of whites. So you can look at examples from Arizona, right? The state of Arizona, when they basically said there's no more Martin Luther King Day, right? Which technically wasn't fully in place, but it had been put into place by one governor, and then they said, okay, we're not gonna do this anymore. And then basically, NFL and NBA, everyone was pulling out, we're not going there. Yet conventions have pulled out of the state, and the business community said, no, we want this day back. because you're hurting our money, right? That's an example of that. Another example of it would be with the civil rights movement, right? And passage of different different acts really kind of ground you more. What happened is, like, over in, like, the Soviet Union, you have to remember, like, there was a lot of, like, tension between the U.S. and the Soviets at that time, Russia, right, USSR, actually, right? And what was taking place is they were taking the examples of people spraying down black people in the streets, right, and people being lynched, and they were putting it all over, and they were using it as propaganda around the world, right? And so there was a lot of pressure, if you look at, like, internal documents within the government, to say, well, we have to do something, right? Because if we don't, it's like it's killing us in terms of the propaganda game, right? And you can look at numerous examples of that. So that's interest convergence. So what you need to think about then is, what are the interests of these people, and then how do I use that to my advantage? So oftentimes when we think about getting at the resistance, we're thinking about, or is there funding opportunities that are on campus? Is there opportunities for release time? And maybe you can't directly give it to them, but maybe there's some sort of process that has embedded priority with. Or maybe it is a process where, you know, if in order to be eligible, you have to have done certain things, right? So funding is one way. Oftentimes we think about compliance, right? Well, if it's embedded within some sort of compliance, that's something that typically might work, right? Or one strategy that sometimes works, it depends upon the relationship between the executive administration and the faculty, but if there's buy-in from the campus leadership. And when I say campus leadership, I'm not just talking about the president, and I'm not just talking about the vice president or the deans. I'm oftentimes talking about the faculty senate president, right? You have a faculty senate president who's bought into this, who says this is important, and you have a campus administration that's really on board with this, then you say, you bring in all the deans, you bring in the department chairs and say, we need everyone to do this, right? And that can help to move folks forward who may be resistors, maybe I have no idea why we're doing this, I don't want to do this, but president says we should do it, so we're going to do it, okay, right? But maybe, hopefully, by giving some exposure to the training, it might change their perception and make them actually start to think a little bit differently. All right, well, hopefully this has been worthwhile. Thank you.